here at the International McNeil Film Studios in beautiful Baja Tustin. I am Nathan McNeil, stepping in for Professor McNeil, and we're going to talk about relationships. Even though this is a social science class, I understand some of you had some questions, so I think he decided to talk about this. Relationships between two or more people. You know, we got celebrities, we got Bradgelina, we got, I don't know if K-Fed and Britney Spears are still a thing, but they probably should be. Relationships between two or more people is, like I just mentioned, variables.
That's not what we're talking about. No, that's not it. Sorry, no.
It's not about that. We're talking about relationships between variables. These are scientific things, things that are connected with each other and by theory. For instance, the displacement of an engine in a vehicle and how fast it goes from 0 to 60. There's a relationship between the engine displacement and how fast it goes from 0 to 60. We're talking about these relationships. So, how do we know that there's a relationship? Well, first of all, between two variables, these are things that change. There are also constants, and those are things that don't change. How do we know that there's a relationship between the displacement and the 0 to 60 speed? Well, we could just test it, but that's a way to confirm a theory, but it's not necessarily the theory itself. There is a theory that explains that you develop more energy when you burn more fuel, and bigger engines burn more fuel, and so they can do more work and move cars faster. That's the theory that explains this relationship. Just doing it again and again and again doesn't necessarily demonstrate the relationship. Theory does. Theory is the story, the explanation of why these two things are related. Now, some relationships are positive. Positive relationships, one variable increases, the other increases. This is like my income and the taxes I pay. If income goes up, the taxes go up. If income goes down, the taxes gloriously will go down as well. But some relationships are negative. That is, when the value of one variable goes up, the value of the other will go down as a consequence. So an example of this would be the price of a Porsche Carrera. If it goes up, fewer will be purchased in our market this week or this month. So there are some relationships that are positive, some that are negative. Positive relationships graph upward from left to right. So if this is the if this is my income, this will be my taxes. If I have very little income, I pay very little taxes. If my income goes up, I pay more taxes. So that's a positive relationship. Negative relationships graph downward from left to right. So if this is, negative relationships graph downward. And so if I go to test this, this one we'll say, and I do a test, and I tell you, we had an engine with a 3-liter displacement beat a vehicle with an engine of a 6-liter displacement. And so I claim that this theory is bad, that the larger the engine displacement, the faster the time going 0 to 60 is. I claim it's not correct because I've proven it wrong. And you say, well, tell me about your test. And I say, well, the 3-liter car was 2,000 pounds. And very aerodynamic. The one that had the 6-liter engine in it was a 10,000 pound truck that was built like a box. And you say, well, wait a minute, that's not a fair test. Right, it's not. When you're going to look at a relationship, you have to look at the relationship ceteris paribus. That means all other things are equal, unchanged, or constant. So in this case, if you want to test the relationship between 0 to 60 speed and engine displacement, then everything else has to be the same. The body, the aerodynamics, the course it's run over, the type of fuel, Everything else that can affect that relationship has to be exactly the same between the two, and the only thing that is different is the displacement. And if you do test this relationship ceteris paribus, the theory will hold. Now, the next term would be slope, and slope is a measure of steepness. So if this is a roof or a graph or a house or a hill, that's one, and this is the other one. Boom, there. Oops, I want it positive. How would you demonstrate that this is more steep than that? And the answer is, you use a ratio of rise to run. Run is horizontal movement. Start anywhere on this hill or graph or whatever it is, roof. And then go out any measured distance. This is the run, horizontal movement. Say the movement is from 6 to 12. So that's 6 run. And then you go back up until you hit the graph or the hill or the roof again. And say that's 12 units. If that's the case, then this ratio of rise is 12 over 6 equals 2 to 1. What that says is, for every 1 unit you run, you're going to rise 2, and that's the steepness ratio. This one, on the other hand, start anywhere again because it's a ratio. Go out, we'll say 20 units. Let's say this is 60, and you go out to 80 here. That's a 20-unit run, and then you go back up until you hit the graph again, and let's say this is 5. So there would be rise, that's vertical movement 5, over run of 20, that's 0.25 over 1. And that ratio, 0.25 over 1, is less than 2 over 1, so this is less steep, that's more steep. Anyway, that's the idea of slope. You can measure slope, rise over. What about a negative slope like that? How do you measure it? Same way again. It's just you run a certain distance, say 10 feet, and then you rise in a negative direction. So in this case, the ratio would be negative 10 over 10, which is equal to negative 1. So for every 1 unit you go run, you're going to rise negative 1 to hit the hill. That's its measure of steepness. Negative relationships always have negative slope. All right, so we are making progress here. The equation of a straight line. Y equals mx plus b, these have parts. This is a variable, that's a variable, x and a y. M is a constant, b is a constant. X is the independent variable, and y is dependent. The value of x can be anything, but once the value of x is determined, that will cause the value of y to be what it is. So that's independent variable, dependent variable, and then the two constants. So I have fleshed it out here with this form for a straight line, y equals 3x plus 5, and if x is 0, if x is 0, then the value of y will be 5. X is 1, the value of y will be 8, etc. Yeah? So for each value of x, the corresponding value of y. And now I want to graph it. So I just start finding these pairs of points on this coordinate system. So when x is 0 here, the value of y is 5. When x is 1, the value of y is 8. When x is 2, the value of y is 11. That's about right there, that point. 2 corresponds to 11. 3 and 14. 4 and 17, etc. And if you'll notice, all of these dots will fall along a straight line here because the slope is constant. Every time you run 1, you're going to rise 3. So that's why. When we look at the names of things here, the M is the slope term, and B is the y-intercept term. Because when the value of x is 0, this graph will cut the y-axis at 5. So, that's that. Now, there are two issues you have to know from this, the takeaways, please. And that is, What happens and what do your eyes see when the value of the independent variable changes? And the answer is, when the value of the independent variable changes from 2 to 3, the value of the corresponding values of the dependent variable change from 11 to 14. And on the graph, you're going to see a movement from this point A to that point B. So it's a movement along the graph. That's what happens when the value of the independent variable changes. You get a movement along the graph. But the next question, of course, is what happens when the value of a constant changes? So for instance, what would happen to this graph if the value of this y-intercept, which is a constant, changes from 5 to 10? And the answer then becomes every corresponding pair of these numbers will change. At if x is 0, y will now be 10, 13, 16, etc. So that now every pair of numbers will be different, and every point on the graph will be different. When x is 0, the value of the function is 10, and then every time x goes up by 1, the value of y will increase by 3. And what we end up with is an entirely different function. It's important to understand that if the value of the independent variable changes, we just move from one point to another on the graph, but if one of the constants changes, we get a shift. That's the important point right there. An example. Demand is a relationship between the price of a particular good in a particular market during a particular period of time. That's demand. A relationship between the price of the good and the quantity that will be purchased in the market during that period of time. So that's demand. But it turns out that price is not the only thing that affects the quantity of something that will be purchased. People's incomes, people's likes and dislikes, the price of available substitutes and complements to that good. There are lots of other things that the number of buyers that will affect the quantity besides just the price. But we believe price is the most important one, and that's why we draw the relationship as the relationship between price and quantity demanded this week. So we assume that this relationship is negative. That is, whenever the price goes up, the quantity goes down, and there's a theory that sort of works that out and confirms it. We assume, when we draw this relationship between price and quantity, we assume ceteris paribus. That is, that all of these other things that can affect the quantity are held constant. So the incomes don't change, the preferences don't change, the price or availability of complements or substitute doesn't change, the number of buyers doesn't change. This is all held constant. Now, if this graph is a series of points, and each point tells you that if the price is P1 here, the quantity that will be purchased in our market is Q1, whatever that quantity is. And sure enough, if we lower the price to P2, what's going to happen is the quantity purchased in our market will increase to Q2. So that's what happens if the value of the independent variable price changes. It will cause the dependent variable's value to change. And we will see it just as a movement from point A to point B. But what if there's something else that changes that affects quantity, something besides price? What if we release this ceteris paribus assumption until one thing changes and then we stop it and see what the effect is? For instance, what if people get higher incomes and this is a normal good? If it's Porsche Carreras, for instance. If the price of a Porsche Carrera is this, the quantity purchased this week will be that. But if people's incomes increase, the quantity will be larger at that price. And at price B2, there would have been that quantity, but if people's incomes increase, the quantity would be larger now because incomes have increased. So at every possible price, the corresponding quantity will increase, and this will cause a shift. So that's it. If there's a change in the independent variable, movement, change in the price of a constant, shift. And this is our little walkthrough of introductory graphy kinds of things. Until next time.